Welcome once again to the Tin Dog Podcast. As you can hear, my voice is largely returned to normal. And before I begin this week's show, which is a review of The Unquiet Dead from 2005 with Christopher Eccleston, I'd just like to thank everyone who's left a comment about the Tin Dog Podcast on iTunes. Thanks very much. Really means a lot. That means that anybody trying to find a new show will come across your reviews. And it should swing them in my direction, because some of them say rather nice things, so thanks very much for that. I have recorded a tribute to Verity Lambert, which I was going to put on the end of this week's show. However, I recorded it for the WhoCast, and as the WhoCast haven't actually broadcast their tribute to Verity Lambert's show, it seems rather bad to put it into this show, so I hope you understand that if you're interested in a Verity Lambert tribute collection, then I recommend that you head over to the WhoCast and listen to that one when it finally gets broadcast. Finally, I'd like to thank the guys at Podshock for having me as part of their show last week when we talked about Colin Baker's time in the TARDIS. It was most enjoyable hanging around, even though I was just fighting off coughing for a huge amount of time. So thanks for having me. I'll try and pop along for the Sylvester McCoy story. Hopefully I'll be there. Thanks, guys. If you do want to contact me, feel free to email me at tin-dog@hotmail.co.uk. The address is repeated at the end of this show. And now, The Unquiet Dead. So far we'd had two episodes of the new series, and things were looking really good. And then The Unquiet Dead came. This is the one I was really looking forward to. Cast-wise, extremely good. The guy out of Chance in a Million, I know he's now down as some world-famous actor, but as far as I'm concerned, he'll always be the guy out of Chance in a Million, and not somebody who was in Four Weddings and a Funeral at all. He was playing Dickens, which, let's face it, he's been doing for some time on stage. And, of course, it was written by Mark Gatiss. Now, anyone who's listened to this podcast knows I'm a big Mark Gatiss fan. Huge fan of The League of Gentlemen. Can't recommend it enough, can't recommend his work enough, his writings, his novels, extremely well written, very, very good. And of course, he's from my end of the woods, if you see what I mean. Why does that sound like a metaphor? No, he's actually from Durham and I'm from Tyne and Wear, as you can probably guess from my accent. Unless you live in America and then all I've said is, I'm from somewhere, he's from somewhere close by. Fair enough. The story, before I start rambling insanely, beyond belief. Basic story, we've had the Doctor deals with things in the present. He then goes and shows off the TARDIS by going to the future. Nice sci-fi story. Thus leaves the list of what Doctor Who does best to historical, pseudo-historical, which is what the historical stories became, i.e. a story set in the past, but with alien influences. The purely historical stories have kind of gone the way of all flesh and only exist these days as Big Finish audios. And to be honest, when I first heard my first purely historical story with one of the remade Doctors, then it came as a surprise because I was just sitting there going, and when are the aliens coming? Oh, there are none. That's weird. I think the first one I experienced was Church and the Crown, and that came as an enormous surprise to me, followed by the Council of Nicaea. Am I totally off the subject? I suspect so. Back to the show? Back to the show. We're still getting used to our brash Ninth Doctor. His accent is beginning to grate on me. What he's wearing, again, still beginning to grate. But I am just pleased that the show is back, that I'm willing to let these things go. Now this trilogy, obviously, as I like to refer to it, isn't a trilogy as such, but it does fit together really well. If you ever had to show this show off to people, this is where you go. And the Gelth, being the villain in this story, work really well. basic Victorian ghost story is fine. It's only looking back on it with hindsight that we realise that, of course, this is the beginning of the Torchwood storylines. We're in Cardiff. We're on the exact spot where Roald Dahl Plaza, which is where Torchwood ends up being, is. The basement of that house is slightly above where the hub of Torchwood will end up being. Of course, we're so ahead of ourselves by this point, it's unbelievable. This could be the most important Doctor Who story, as Russell called it later, that you just didn't notice. This one, and of course, that one with the Slovene in it. Shall we just move on? There is one thing that I do worry about. Not worry so much as wonder when it comes to this story. And this is another tangent I've gone off at. When I was reviewing the show again, just for editing, there's one line that just threw me. When Mr. Sneed says, "Gwyneth, where have you been?" And Gwyneth answers, "I was breaking the ice off from Samson." Now, is this so he could have a drink, or is this some euphemism for a very, very cold horse? It's made me wonder every so often. It doesn't make me lose sleep, but I do wonder about it. So if anyone knows the answer, give me a shout. Other moments worthy of mentioning in this story, of course, and I am assuming that you've seen this, is when Charles Dickens and the Doctor are in the coach together. And the Doctor is telling Charles Dickens what a huge fan he is. Now for me, and of course for a lot of other people, what he's actually doing is becoming a Doctor Who fan of the writers of the series, if you see what I mean. The Doctor's reaction to Charles Dickens is our reaction to the people who do Doctor Who. We start saying lovely things, and then eventually we start going, "Yeah, but what about this story? It was rubbish." Or, "Can I just call you Charlie?" Things that you just wouldn't normally do. This is the second appearance, obviously. The first guy, Clive in Rose, he was an example of the same sort of thing. But of course now we're seeing it from a slightly different point of view. But at its core, what is this story truly about? Well, for me, it's about guilt. And it's also about discovering what's actually going on. The old school fans know about Gallifrey, they know about the Time Lords, they know about a load of other things. Stuff that you suspected weren't quite true about this new series. This whole business of being the last of the Time Lords, very important to Russell, very important to a few people, not as important to us. I was a big 80s Doctor Who fan, and in the 80s you couldn't get moved for Time Lords and big silly collars. But I liked them. I liked the Time Lords. I liked the idea of that much power and that much apathy being in the same place. This is where we're starting to learn about things that were mentioned in the last episode. When we found out that there shouldn't be any more Time Lords in the last story at the end of the world, we're now presented with the Time War. Ooh, how excited did that make people? Outpost Gallifrey leapt at the words Time War. It all got very exciting. Who were the villains? What had happened? Now the clever money, or the not so clever money, and to be honest, the obvious money, went for Daleks. But everybody else, the people who were too drenched in Doctor Who history to really move on, with things like, "Oh, it's faction paradox, oh, it's this other creature, oh, it's somebody from the books, oh, it's somebody from the audio adventures, oh," it was the Daleks, wasn't it? Of course we didn't realise that yet, and all we knew for certain was that there was a Time War. We're not quite sure what format that would take, and of course how much of the Doctor's own history had been rewritten by that, even if it was his own TARDIS. Little ideas like that spun round our heads. And of course, we'll never know the answers, because any of our authors worth their salt won't tell us these things, because the Time War in our own heads is so much more impressive than anything that would appear on a screen. Every single Doctor Who fan has their own version of the Time War, and I guess every single version is true. It's the Doctor's guilt that lets him want to help the Gelf. But I suspect all of the other Doctors would have wanted to help them as well. Again, we're back to the hand-holding. Again, we're back to Rose talking about, "Oh, how I'm going to die before I've been born. How could that happen?" Come off it, pet. Everyone's aware of that. I mean, let's face it. In the Shakespeare code, even Martha just says, "Oh, it's like Back to the Future." And admittedly, the Doctor says, "Oh, the novelisation." And I know for a fact that there was one, because I owned it. In a time before VHS, novelizations were a marvellous thing. Oh, look, I've digressed yet again. Themes are beginning to be noticed in this show. Themes are coming out, themes are being more obvious. Rose gets separated from the Doctor, goes off and talks to the staff. And I know it's the same actress who ends up in Torchwood. How confusing is that for anyone into continuity? But, oh look, Rose is talking to members of staff. It's going to become a theme, and you know, it will. Admittedly, the whole Rose, I'm not going to die before I was born thing did lend itself to a recreation of that scene with Sarah Jane Smith in Pyramids of Mars, which I think was the original intent reading of some of the production notes. And, like most production notes, they end up with that scene being dropped for in exchange for a little bit of exposition. Exposition. It's nice that the word phantasmagoria gets used by Mark Gatiss as well, because of course that's the name of his Big Finish story, and it gets used repeatedly in League of Gentlemen things. I guess it's just one of those words he likes. I'm sorry if this isn't as well structured as normal. I will try and make much more clear notes in future. But remember, we are the Doctor's number one fan, each and every one of us.
Once I found a stowaway upon my ship on Christmas Day, I was fair, so I gave him a chance. You shouldn't be here, what's your tale? I ought to throw you to the whale. He just smiled and said, come here, let's dance. He said, for I was ill, I'll find a way to be with my lover upon Christmas Day. And I'll run and I'll roam, I'll cover the ground. This Christmas I'll see you, I'll be around.
I just want to say that there was a plan. A plan to take Murray Gould and give us a Doctor Who number one at Christmas. The section of music that you may have just heard is from the Doctor Who soundtrack album, and there is a concerted effort by us, the fans, to make that the new Christmas number one, especially in England. So, this week, why don't you pop onto iTunes, or however you buy your records, find it. I think it's track 26. It's called Stowaway. And why not download it? Because if enough of us do this, then that could make it into charts. And that would be a lovely Christmas present for a lot of people. Doctor Who in the charts? Ah. Is this manipulation or is it just an advert? I don't know, but all I know is that I'm going to do that. Product endorsement? Well, it's my show, I can do whatever I want. Can I? I don't know, I can't remember. Look, I'll leave it, and I will speak to you either before Christmas. Actually, I'll speak to you next week. Let's face it, it's only 2 weeks. Is it 2 weeks away? 3 weeks away? Good Lord. I better go and buy some presents. Be seeing you. You have been listening to the Tin Dog Podcast. Doctor Who and its associated shows are all trademark of the BBC. No infringement is intended. Contact us at tin-dog@hotmail.co.uk.